One of the most challenging emotions that we can all suffer from is regret, because it's something that appears so difficult to get rid of or to deal with, because it's usually based on something that did authentically already happen or not happen, depending on whatever the regret may be. So we have to learn to live with it. And research shows that the sense of loss or sorrow about what might have been or should have been can produce an enormous amount of chronic, often unconscious stress and eventually damage to both the mind and the body, because it is this seemingly unchangeable problem. And it becomes a form of self-blame. It can prevent us from engaging with life properly, and it becomes the source of many mental health problems because of the self-blame and stress and this eventually depression because of regret. Regret is a major cause of depression. And then it's often exploited in our society, where you get like advertisements and social media that blame you for the past, that tell you what you should have done. Like, you know, those funeral adverts that you should have prepared for the elderly person's death, or you should have got that insurance, and everything is about what you should have been and what you could have been. And what we really need to distinguish is the difference between could have and should have, because how we distinguish between those things is often related to how we understand ourselves. Could we really have done it? So it's this discrepancy between who we really are and who we think we ought to have been or should have been. And in a nutshell, you're much more likely to dwell on what you could have been than what you should have been. So learning the difference between could have, should have, the real self, the ideal self, is one of the most important ways to firstly improve our sense of self, and secondly, get out of the trap of regret. Your actual self is your own self-concept of yourself, how you represent yourself to yourself, the traits that you think you have, the attributes that you think you have. Your ideal self is, of course, the attributes you would like to have, often related to future goals or wishes and things that other people might have. And then there's the ought-to self that is the qualities you believe you ought to possess rather than want to possess. The ideal ones you really wish you did. The ought ones are the ones that you wish you did, but you don't. I should have. And so often duties and obligations and social pressures create the ought to self. And when there's a discrepancy between what you ought to be, what you should have been, and what you ideally want to be and what you are, and any of those things, we become negative in some form. We experience negative emotions. We experience regret or depression when we believe that we're failing to live up to what our ideal self or ought to self might be. Failing to live up to the ideal self can produce disappointment, sadness, regret. And the ought to, failing to live up to the ought to self, can produce guilt, fear, and depression. Things that ought to be coming from social pressure of some kind. So what we need to do is ultimately self-reflect and start working on, who am I really? Who am I? And as we shall talk, we need to have a way to look at our regrets and find a way to move past them, which I'll talk about a little bit later in the show. Regrets stick around, very much what we could have done, not what we did do, is what regret has done. Even when we did do something wrong, we tend not to focus on what we did wrong and tend to focus on what we could have done right. And the could haves are really impossible to deal with because they're in the past. And this is one of the problems with regrets. We hang on to them for years. They come up every day, or a situation might trigger them. And, you know, in the end, they're these things that live with us all the time. And if they live with us all the time, They need to be useful. They need to be a better company. We need to find a way to make them a bit more functional, to let them help us move forward and teach us not to make the same mistakes again. The truth is, though, the regrets that won't go away, these ones that I'm referring to that live with us every day, are the ones that separate us from our ideal self. It's that sense of inaction related to this unrealized ideal self that can cause the most long-term sorrow. And judging ourselves by an ideal is rather questionable, because is that ideal any less social pressure than the ought to, which comes from social pressure and produces so much guilt or sorrow? It is true, though, that we intuitively know that regrets control our mood and make us miserable. So you might make a move and regret leaving your family. You can do something about that. You can go back and visit them all the time. But there's some things that we leave behind that you can do nothing about. Should have said yes, I said no, now she's married to someone else. And those are the ones that we can do nothing about. Or things like, I always wanted to learn the piano and I never did, and now I'm too old. So we have these once in a lifetime type of things that get away and we have perpetual regret with. We process these different kinds of regrets in different ways. So while, maybe I shouldn't have moved at that time, but I ended up getting that job over there, often we can find a way to improve the situation. But some of those that are stuck in the past, we can't do anything about. So sometimes if we look back at a past relationship and what we did and what they did, and we feel guilty about something that we've done, well, we can't leave that unresolved. And because it's in the past, because that person might not be around anymore, or you might not be in that same place, we don't have a way to resolve that. And we have this lingering guilt and this lingering judgment of ourselves not living up to the ideal self. Whereas when it's just a path we didn't take, it doesn't always produce that same kind of pressure. So one of the ways to understand our own regrets is to ask ourselves the question, why do I regret that? What has the consequence been in my life? What has the outcome been in our lives? And learn to identify when we are creating an emotional situation out of something in the past that we cannot do anything about. So if we fail to take action on something that is a regret about a path not taken, there isn't a strong response like anger or guilt when regret is about a mistake. So the different kinds of regrets is, are we regretting something I didn't do, or am I regretting something I did do? When we regret something we didn't do, it doesn't push us so strongly emotionally, although it might still be worth a bit of examination. But it's when we regret something that we did do that we experience the greatest consequences in some way. And so failing to take action that could have made us happier, could have made us more like our ideal self, leads to the feelings of sadness and disappointment and things that we often put into kind of storage and will deal with later. And later doesn't come. And we carry around a lot of these negative emotions. It's always worth looking at the negative emotions that we carry around. Even if sadness or disappointment are not like burning emotions, like anger that pushes us to something. When we're feeling anger, we kind of have to do something about it, and often we will. If we're feeling sadness or disappointment, especially something that happened a year ago, and then it's 2 years ago, and then it's 5, 10, and 20 years ago, well, it's described as a cold emotion. It doesn't urge us or push us or do anything like that. But 20 years of regret 20 years of sadness or disappointment can do an enormous amount of damage, even if it isn't something that's burning hot that I need to do something about right now. So at some point, we need to face the past. We need to stop pining for a past that never was. Shai Davidi, another psychologist, argues that it's better for us to dig into the past and dig into the old regrets and sorrows and become used to them and understand what they are, because that will help us understand how we responded and how we could respond. And learning to choose an imperfect solution rather than regretting that we didn't get the ideal version all the time. So we need to basically stop pining for the what ifs and rather ask ourselves, what can I do about it? I can't change what did happen or what should have happened, but I can look at how it's affected me and see what can I do about this. So David says, let's say you're in a job that you don't necessarily enjoy, or maybe that you regret having entered into all those years ago. Feeling stuck is fine, but you must turn that into a hot emotion like anger. So you don't have to be angry about it. But if you can't change your job or some other circumstance, change the circumstances of your job. You can do the work. You can reframe it in some way. So it's this approach that says, look at your regrets, understand that they exist and cannot be gotten rid of. So what exactly do you want to do about it? So what can we do to minimize regret or minimize the effects of it? It is important to bear in mind, as psychologist Dr. Todd Kashdan points out, that regret can be useful. Like most of our defense mechanisms and things like that, they actually exist for a reason. So the feeling of guilt or embarrassment when we regret something that we've done is really meant to motivate us to self-reflect and hopefully make better decisions in the future. So we can't avoid regret, because there's always a cost for a decision. There's always an alternative. There's always, you know, when you choose one path, you've just rejected 20 other paths. So regret is inevitable. And that's why, rather than continuously experience it as a negative experience, we've really got to ask ourselves, how can I benefit from looking at the situation and learning about myself? Not necessarily buying so fully into the regret that says, yes, the situation tells me I should have done that, and now I can regret that forevermore. But rather, the feeling of regret tells me I didn't examine those options, I didn't consider this, I succumbed to my desire for that. Whatever it may be, seeing the larger picture and realize it's an opportunity to learn about ourselves. Often if we ignore regrets, we increase anxieties. So it is important to find a balance and find a way that regret teaches us about risk and calculated risks, easy versus difficult goals, and how we might be learning about ourselves. So in coping with regret, there are a couple of things that we can think about that make it an easier process. The first one is, what can I learn from that? What can I know about myself? What am I doing to harm myself? While regret might not be a good thing much of the time, you know, if a criminal didn't regret their actions, they would never reform. So sometimes we need to understand that regret is signaling that our choices are not good. So rather look at the choices than the regret. The second thing we can think about is letting go. Sometimes regret is a form of self-blame, and self-blame strongly affects self-esteem. So we find a way to let go. Forgiving ourselves and letting go of the past is a very important way to deal with regret. And I mean, it's often easier to forgive others than it is to forgive ourselves. So sometimes you need to think about, what would you say to another person in the situation? How would you make them feel better about it? Say that to yourself. And thirdly, make sure you're not taking the blame when the blame isn't yours or it's out of proportion and you're blaming yourself for everything that happened. So understand how maybe the circumstances made it difficult to make the right choice. Maybe you didn't know enough at the time to make the right choice. Maybe there was no time to make the right choice. So look at the situation and make sure that the regret kind of is in proportion with how much of the blame is actually yours. And then find a positive way to reframe the situation. You know, thinking about how learning from mistakes, life is a journey. The way that I've learned about my reactions, my triggers, my decisions is something that benefits us in the future. When it comes to our friends, the Stoics approach, well, the Stoics had the view that all negative emotions are unhealthy. So regret is classified as a negative emotion and therefore it is unhealthy. And of course, one of the most important functions of Stoic philosophy or purposes of it is to free us from our negative passions or the things that we're not in control of and to achieve a dispassionate state of equanimity, an equal, calm attitude towards events that doesn't provoke an emotional response. So yes, the Stoics say we must learn from our mistakes, we must learn from past events, but we must do it with equanimity. We mustn't indulge in guilt or regret or anything that makes us feel bad about the past because the past cannot be changed. So the Stoics are not talking about the importance of, as I have, using regret to improve our actions. They're always focusing on the present, on what's controllable and what you need to do to maintain that state of equanimity. So the unchangeability of the past is very key to the Stoic idea of focus on what you are in control of. You are in control of the present. So acting better in the present is, of course, that Stoic equivalent of learning from the past mistakes. But of course, Epictetus says, of all things existing, some things are in our power and some things are not in our power. In our power are thought, impulse, will to get and will to avoid, and everything which is our own doing. Things not in our power include our body, our property, our reputation, our office, status in the world, and in a word, he says, everything which is not our own doing. So the argument against regret is that it interferes with our attempt to get the state of equanimity and it ignores the issue of what are you in control of, what are you not in control of, that very key issue. Epictetus tells a story where he says you've really got to be like a judge. Every day you've got to inquire of yourself, what bad habits did you indulge in today? What bad habits did you cure today? Where did you succumb to anger or regret or some other emotion today? And in what respect did you learn from that? Are you better from that? And so on. And he says, the thing is, if you did that every day, then the anger and the regret, et cetera, naturally lessen because unconsciously or consciously, you know that you're going to appear before the judge at the end of the day. You're the judge. So if you learn to self-reflect and do that every day about why did that happen? How could I have done better? It actually modifies the behavior in the same way your behavior would modify if you knew that you were going to appear before some kind of real judge. There is one more thing about regret that the Stoics say, and that's, of course, our friend Marcus Aurelius, the great Stoic. And he says, essentially, regretting something is this continuous dialogue with yourself about how bad you've been. So it makes this constant argument that you should feel sad or ashamed or something like that. And Stoicism is about action, not about words. Marcus says, no longer talk at all about the kind of man that a good man ought to be, just be such, which is the bottom line. It is completely natural to wonder about what could have been, what your life could have been, or what that choice might have been, or what would have been different about the things I regret. But the issue is, how is the regret useful to you? So as Marcus says, as the psychologists have said, the first step in reducing regret and letting go of it is knowing yourself. Knowing yourself in the end is how we let go of the past, how we let go of bad things, bad habits, because we see the consequences they produce, and how in the end we live with equanimity. The Stoic philosophy of moving forward was like the Stoic philosophy of understanding your locus of control. It was perhaps one of the most important things about their philosophy at all. The other great Stoic, I often refer to Seneca, said essentially, moving forward is the only important thing. Live the life you have as best as you can, and understand that all the time that has passed is owned by death. That's what Seneca said. All the time that has passed is owned by death, because it's gone. It can't be regained. There's nothing you can do about it. Similarly, then, says Seneca, the mistakes you have made are owned by death. And so leave that to death. One of the Stoic exercises is literally write down all your mistakes and then destroy the piece of paper that you just wrote that on to show your unconscious self how you really grasp that they're gone. They're now owned by death. There's nothing I can do about them. They exist in a non-state. They're not with me in the present, which is the only thing that is real. The Stoics may have lived a very long time ago, but like a lot of ancient people, they understood some core things which we keep on circling around to as a species. And one of them is that time is an illusion. When that's philosophical or physical or metaphysical idea, time is an illusion because to all intents and purposes, only the present exists. Whatever might be the reason, whether there is a physics reason for that or not, from our consciousness point of view, only the present exists. We cannot reach into the past and we cannot reach into the future. We can just look towards it. We can't reach into the past, so Seneca says, it's owned by death. It's in that same place where you cannot go, like a non-place. The past is that non-place. It's therefore exactly like death. You cannot do anything with it or about it or change it or engage with it in any kind of way. Seneca says, be smart about that. And the things that you didn't do or the things that you did do that you shouldn't have or couldn't have are in that past. Looking forward doesn't mean you can see the future, but it does mean that you can use your understanding of those regrets to make the better choices, to recognize a path that takes you more towards what you can be. And maybe if we understood that, and the ideal self is not something we should be, but something that we continuously are becoming. And once we understand that really everything about us is something that we are continuously becoming, for me, that's a way that we can really learn to undo regrets. Something I often tell perfectionists: perfection is an end state. Idealism is the ideal is an end state. And what follows the end? Well, there's nothing that follows the end. You can't have more perfect or more ideal. But nature shows us that things are moving forward, that, you know, time might be an illusion, but it doesn't stand still. Whatever it is, it doesn't stand still. That's for sure. And so that means something can't get more perfect or more ideal, which kind of means that it can only get less perfect after that, because something can get less perfect. So once we achieve perfection or once we achieve the ideal, it can only break down from there. And that's just a way of reminding ourselves that, well, let's take a few steps. Let's always work towards perfect, but never really get there. Because if I get there, I kind of must be dead. And the same goes for idealism, the self that I should have been. Let me rather always work towards that. Instead of saying, I should have and it's gone, even to that dead past, we can say, well, maybe I should have or could have, but I'm still here. I'm still becoming. I'm forever learning from what I didn't do and working on what I am doing. There's never a state that says, I can regret not being me, because I'm forever working on this me as long as I'm here. That's why we also have no regrets, because you can always continue to become. I'll see you next week.